to the Africans, buying the island in Uganda and using it for a secret weapons and drug factory seemed to be right up the alley of the North Koreans, which was kind of important to prove. But it did not stop there, because while in Uganda, the North Korean arms dealer, Mr. Danny, was ready to take the joint venture a step further.
We can meet in the lobby. When will you be there? Okay, I look forward to see you. Take care. Bye-bye.
You said you had some things you needed to move as well.
Yeah. So, for example, you move all items to the Middle East country. The destination is Syria. How about Syria?
Syria. Well, what kind of items they want there?
Projectile, bomb, something like that.
Okay.
If you can do, you have the capability to transport all items from our countries to the Syria, and you give the signal, and then I'll go to Beijing. We can be discuss more in time.
North Koreans needing to move armaments to Syria is actually a very interesting piece of information, so please allow me to digress a little bit. Historically, North Korea and Syria have been friends for many years, and the North Koreans were even building a nuclear reactor in the Syrian desert until the Israelis decided to blow it up. During the civil war in Syria, the New York Times published a story about how North Korea was helping the Syrian regime with its chemical weapons program. At the same time, small arms from North Korea have been found in the hands of fighters from the Islamic State, but most likely these weapons were stolen from the Syrian army. So, when the North Korean arms dealer, Mr. Danny, wants to send bombs and projectiles to Syria, the end user is probably the Syrian regime.
So what did you say to Danny when he suggested that you help with the Syria war?
I said yes. I would like to do that. And then he said that then you have to go to Beijing.
Something I still feel bad about is sending Mr. James to Beijing to meet with North Korean arms dealers. People who are in the know about the dark side advised us strongly against it. Because if the Chinese intelligence service would shine their lights on Mr. James, it would be another ball game entirely. But Mr. James is a man who craves action, and I am a filmmaker who craves sensation, so he went anyway.
Before I'm going to Beijing, I've been in contact with Mr. Danny, who say he had passed it on to his collaboration partner, and he will take it forward. Sit down, and as custom, I brought you something from Denmark.
Wow.
One for you, and one for you. It's the first day. There's only two gentlemen arriving, and one of them introduced himself to be the main guy of the weapon industry.
Both men are North Korean. I know this because sometimes they speak Korean to each other in the dialect of the North. Clearly, the two men are in the know about the island in Uganda, which seems to be a top priority. But can they trust Mr. James?
I don't know if Danny has already talked to you about the business we are doing.
Your weapon, huh?
A weapon, okay.
Yeah. He said to me, we have a collaboration with Syria, but our problem is to give them the armoury. Okay. Do you think you can help us? Is that correct?
Yeah, Syria.
You have contacts in Syria?
Yeah.
If you give me a list of the people that you officially not can contact, then I can contact them because I can travel here and there on behalf of you.
Exactly. The man smoking here? No? Outside?
I don't know.
Okay. I go to the toilet. You turn the toilet.
The toilet is out there.
And
No, it's in there.
Asking for names of clients and contacts in the world of arms dealing seems to be a showstopper.